Verse 21. And going on from thence, he saw other two brethren, James the son of Zebedee and John his brother, in a ship with Zebedee their father, mending their nets. And he called them. And they immediately left the ship and their father and followed him. And Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people. Notice here in Matthew chapter 4, verse 23, is the verse that tells it all, that we are to teach, preach, and heal. He went about teaching, preaching, and then healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people. Notice the sequence in which his ministry went forth to touch the people. The sequence was first that he taught. Secondly, that he preached the gospel that the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And thirdly, he healed. Teaching, preaching, and then healing. Why did the healing follow the teaching and the preaching? The teaching and preaching of the Word of God produces faith in your heart. And it also produces faith in you when you're sick, at the very point of your need, no matter what that need is. It doesn't matter what manner of disease it is. What matters is, are you being taught? Are you receiving the preaching of the Word of God? You see, you can know through the teaching and preaching that your faith will come up out of your heart. And in order to be like Jesus, we teach, preach, and heal. In the spring of 1947, when I was a student in the university and also pastoring a small church, the Lord Jesus spoke in my heart and told me to be like Jesus and heal the people as he did. When I asked him how to be like Jesus, he told me to read the four Gospels and the book of Acts on my knees consecutively, 3 times in 30 days, and he would show me Jesus. I remember when I got to Matthew 4:23, that this verse leaped up from the page and in effect said, oral, to be like Jesus, you must teach, you must preach, and you must heal. This is what Jesus did. And my friend, this is the divine and the ageless formula for Christians today. This is the formula of Jesus himself. And when you and I have Christ in our heart, this is the formula we are to use. Verse 24, and his fame went throughout all Syria, and they brought unto him all sick people that were taken with divers diseases and torments, and those which were possessed with devils, and those which were lunatic, and those that had the palsy, and he healed them. And there followed him great multitudes of people from Galilee, and from Decapolis, and from Jerusalem, and from Judea, and from beyond Jordan. Note, it's important to understand that Jesus apparently did not heal everybody who was sick, but he healed every kind of disease. Those people who represented each disease came and they were healed by the Lord. Somehow he wants us to understand that there is no disease resistant to the healing power of Jesus Christ. And I believe that. No, all people are not healed. All people apparently are not going to be healed. But we can be assured that every manner of disease is being healed as we teach, preach, and heal in the name of Jesus. Please notice also the term that he healed people who were taken with divers diseases and torments. Jesus healed people emotionally of their fears and stresses. He healed people of their diseases such as palsy, which is, in many instances, a reference to a birth defect. He healed people of diseases, ailments of long standing. He healed people who were mentally ill, and the word is used here as lunatic. He healed those who were possessed with devils, whose personalities were infected by an indwelling demon. Now, Jesus is placed in the chemicals of this earth many of these healing powers. But he has not left us without his own supernatural touching of our lives. Because when Jesus healed, we're told that something went out of him. He said, I perceive that power has gone out of me. He has built healing into the very universe in which we live. He has added to that something coming out of him as a person, his supernatural power. In addition, he has put healing properties and abilities within our own bodies, minds, and souls. I say this to doctors. I say this to teachers, to preachers, to evangelists, to prophets, to lay people. I say it to everybody and to myself, that he's the source of all health and healing. It's possible for us to be healed. There's a reality of it. And we can stand upon the Word of God and upon our faith in Christ that we can be healed from the crown of our heads, the soles of our feet. Jesus is here also speaking of root causes of disease. He speaks of those who are tormented. That is to say, there's some inner something that's wrong. Something wrong in our mental abilities. There's a torment there. He speaks also of diseases themselves, which have a terrific effect upon the mind. Now, our doctors talk about psychosomatic diseases, of diseases coming up out of our own emotions. But let's turn that around and realize that diseases in our bodies also affect our emotions. I can tell you, having been a sick man and having gone through some very terrible afflictions in my body, that it tore my emotions up. It brought great torment to me. Therefore, as we approach the healing of people through the power of medicine and through the power of prayer, we must understand the root of those diseases. We're making a determined effort at the research tower of the City of Faith to find a root cure for a root cause. And we know that God is with us. And we thank God for every partner who's standing with us in this gigantic effort to obey our God and find the root cause of disease and discover his cure for it. And this may affect more people favorably than anything else that we've ever done to bring healing to the people. Although we don't discount anything that God has done through us to bring healing to humanity. Chapter 5. This chapter begins the Beatitudes, or what we commonly call the Sermon on the Mount, that our Lord Jesus Christ gave. A beatitude given here by our Lord Jesus Christ is a statement of a blessing of heaven, of an attitude of the Spirit that is divine reality, and that brings the greatest happiness to the human being even here on this earth. Matthew, in recording this sermon of Christ, probably did it over a period of time. You see, he had heard Jesus wherever he gave all or part of this message. And in keeping notes, he was able then at the inspired time to write the whole sermon in its entirety, verse by verse, word by word, so that you and I could read it in the same way. I have a real deep feeling about this sermon, not only because that it is Jesus' message to us today, but because I've been at the traditional place where he gave it. I've spoken there to many people, the Word of God by my own lips. I have sensed, in effect, the very presence of God on that piece of ground where Jesus sat and gave this message. And now let's begin chapter 5. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Note, he did not say, Blessed are those who are in poverty, because poverty is no blessing to anybody. If poverty is a blessing, then the billions on earth who are starving are blessed indeed. If poverty is a blessing to you, why don't you ask God for more? No, God wants to supply all our needs upon this earth. Here Jesus is speaking to us in how to be humble in our spirit. Remember, he said of himself, For I am lowly in heart. Verse 4, Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Note, mourn here is a reference to the compassion that Jesus had for suffering people, and which he wants us to have, and even says when we have it, we are blessed of God. It means the same thing that we read in Matthew 14:14, quote, And when Jesus saw the multitude, he came toward them, moved with compassion, and healed their sick, end of quote. Compassion is not a human trait. Sympathy is. Sympathy extended to people in need only creates self-pity. But compassion is supernatural. It's divine love. It's God's love going off inside us. It's feeling the way that God feels toward other people, particularly in their suffering. So when he says, Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted, he in effect is saying, Blessed are they who are compassionate, for I will see to it that they will receive compassion themselves. Verse 5, Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Note, meekness is not equated with weakness. Christianity has become a stumbling block to many who think that being born again is to make them doormats of society. But it means a lot like my mother always said to me when she said, Oral, be little in your own eyes and obey God. What Mama was telling her son Oral was, don't be big-headed, don't think too highly of yourself, but see in the way that God sees, love the way that he is, and obey what he tells you to do. Submit your will to his. Don't go around boasting. Except in Christ, and that his adequacy is complete for your inadequacies. You know, Jesus was tender with children, but I'll tell you, he was strong against the money changers in the temple, driving them out as he upset their tables and telling them that you've made my Father's house a den of merchandise, but it is a house of prayer. Moses is said to be the meekest man who ever lived, and yet he took on the wicked and violent Pharaoh in Egypt single-handedly. No, it does not mean that meekness is weakness, but Jesus is saying you're blessed when you submit your life to me and let me live my life through you, because I, who own the heaven and the earth, will cause you to inherit the earth. Verse 6, Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Note, Jesus is here speaking of the keen appetite and deep craving that we who are born again can have. In thinking his thoughts and in doing things the way he does them, desiring above all things to have right relations with God in everything we do and everything we are, that deep desire to see God's righteous ways triumph in this world. Jesus' statement here is absolute. You shall have your hunger satisfied. Verse 7. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Note, when Jesus speaks here of being merciful, I think we ought to remember him on the cross. And he prayed to the Father, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. To be merciful, I think that we have to take God's view rather than our own. God sees it in the scope of eternity and in the realm of divine love, which is the real reality of life. That's right, love is the real reality of life. And then when he speaks of pure in heart, he's really talking about singleness of heart. That honesty that has no hidden motive. He's speaking of not having a divided self, one that is trying to serve God in the world at the same time, but possessing the very nature of Jesus himself. And because of that, we shall see God. And then he says, blessed are the peacemakers, those who keep the peace. Remember, God says that he's the God of peace. And Christ in the Bible is described as the Prince of Peace. And the Bible speaks of that peace in our hearts that passes all understanding. Peace. Blessed are the peacemakers. Well, it's so easy to divide people. So easy to repeat tales. And to say things we hear other people say and run and tell it so that we tear people's hearts out of them. One of the things we'll learn in Paul's writings is how specifically to deal with divisions among God's people. Jesus said there's a great happiness in this, and I know it to be true. And then he adds, when you do that, you shall be called the children of God. Verse 10. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Note, Jesus described the treatment that you and I as born again believers are going to experience in this world. As a matter of fact, we simply have to be open to the persecution that is inevitable. It's going to come strictly because we are living for Christ. He's saying, blessed are you when you allow yourself to be persecuted. When you do not flee from doing God's work just because the opposition rises against you. You know, friend, it is not at the edge of our Christian living that these persecutions strike us, but they come when we are really doing the work of the Lord for his sake. I repeat, for his sake. We've become so involved with Jesus Christ's life that what we do is for his sake. Jesus pronounces a blessing upon us when we stand We just stand. As Paul says in Ephesians 6, having done all to stand, stand therefore. I remember a man converted in my crusade, whom I later met, and who was facing extreme persecution through his testimony of Christ, said to me, Oral Roberts, you described to me that when I came to Christ, that I would be blessed. I'm not as blessed now as I was before I was converted. Most people said nice things about me, but now they're coming at me from every side. I said, what are you doing? Well, he said, I've begun reading my Bible. I've begun to try to practice the love of God, to be nice to people, to stand up for what's right in my community. And all of a sudden, all hell has burst loose against me. Well, I said, you know, Jesus said that's one of his blessings. Blessed are you when you're reviled falsely for Jesus' sake. You're shining a light for the path of those who walk in the darkness of sin. And he said, I'm going to have to think this over. Well, I can speak for Oral Roberts. I've been thinking it over a long time. And in my own experience, I discover the closer I am to Christ and the more sincerely and openly I do his work, the more I'm assured that I will be accused falsely for Jesus' sake. I also admit that sometimes I'm persecuted for my own faults. And I admit to you there's no joy in that. We suffer for our Lord when we know in our heart that our motive is right, that we're doing it because of the Word of God telling us to do it, and to follow in his footsteps. But Jesus gives a wonderful word to us that we are blessed people. Verse 13, ye are the salt of the earth, but if the salt have lost his savour, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing but to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men. Note, salt gives flavor. Salt preserves. And it's at the very heart of all that we eat. Our Lord is saying that we who live for him are the flavor. We're the flavor of this world. Because his flavor, the flavor of his own divine nature, has filled our lives. In flavoring our lives and preserving our lives, we in turn give a beautiful flavor to this world and are the preservers of this world. Did you know if you took God's people out of this world today, all the forces of the Antichrist would immediately be manifested? The devil would take over and make mankind so completely godless that there would be no flavor of life. There would be nothing to hold people together. We as believers should know that we can live an effective life for Jesus Christ in the same way that salt is an effective flavor and preservative. And we are the salt of the earth. Now hear that. You are the salt of the earth. And God is complimenting you by calling you the salt of the earth. Verse 14. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on an hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men, that they may see your good works, and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Note, when we are in Christ, we don't conceal ourselves. He says, your light, let it shine. Let it shine. You know, the thing that our Lord is grieved about is all those people who say they're Christians but declare it's a private matter. And it's their own business and nobody else's business. If you're a closet Christian, all your light is in the closet. It's in nobody's house. It's not in business. It's not in your everyday relationships. Listen, light is light. And you can come into a room that is absolutely dark and strike a match, and the light will penetrate the total darkness of that room. Jesus is so thrilled here about our being the light of the world, he wants us to accept the fact that we are light and let it shine. Verse 17, think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. Note, this is the first time that Matthew has Jesus saying, verily I say unto you, or truly I say unto you. For then Jesus speaks of his divine authority, the authority that's above all authority, as the great lawgiver himself, verily I say unto you. Now here, he's speaking to Jewish believers and unbelievers too, people who are bound up in keeping the law of Moses. Their whole lives are concerned with it. And Jesus is speaking of his own personal relationship to the law of Moses. To those who were fearful Jesus would not have proper reverence for the authority and principles of the Old Testament, or would hope he would become a religious revolutionary concerning it, Jesus issued a categorical statement. I came not to annul or abrogate the Old Testament, the Old Covenant. I came not to do away with the laws that my father gave Moses. I came to fulfill the purpose for which that law was given. By keeping it perfectly in spirit and embodying the principle of it in myself in living form, and by paying the full penalty of the law's demands against sin by becoming the Redeemer for sin. Now that's what Jesus was saying. And at that point he said, truly I say unto you. And then indicated that he wouldn't change even a jot or a tittle. Now Jesus, in speaking of the jot and the tittle, is making a direct reference, number one, that the jot is the smallest Hebrew letter, like an apostrophe, and tittle is a stroke which distinguishes some Hebrew letters from others. As he says, not the smallest letter or stroke will pass from the law of Moses until all is fulfilled. Jesus is clearly speaking of the unerring accuracy of the Word of God. Verse 19, whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I say unto you, that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, ye shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven. Note, I want to emphasize again the preciseness with the way which our God works. Jesus is saying there was an absolute reason for the giving of the law and for the commandments to be lived out by men. Although he has come as the Messiah to fulfill them, he is saying that if any of us break even the tiniest part of those commandments and shall teach other men to break them, we are actually the smallest or the least people in the kingdom of heaven. But if we do them and teach them, we'll be great in the kingdom of God. And therefore, he says, except your righteousness shall exceed that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will not enter into the kingdom of God. Jesus was always surrounded by the scribes and Pharisees, who on the one hand were doing some wonderful things, but on the other hand were so motivated by ulterior motives that they were far, far from the kingdom of God. A scribe was a highly trained person, skilled in the Word of God, and capable of reproducing it in writing so precisely that every T was crossed and every I was dotted. Well, now, what happened? The scribes would carry that over to the commandments of God in keeping the letter of them, keeping the outward form of them, seeing that every T was crossed, every I was dotted, but leaving out their inner and real meaning. On the other hand, the Pharisees were a group of Jewish people who were zealous for the law of Moses, and in that they were correct. They began a revival among a backslidden people to get them to return to keep the commandments of God. But when Jesus arrived, they had so degenerated in spirit, they had become legalistic. That is to say, they had placed their main emphasis upon the outward observance of that law. For example, in the law of Moses, the Sabbath day was to be kept holy and no work done during that day. But when the Pharisees came along, they overemphasized what God had in mind, and before they got through, they had about 100 books of definitions of what you could and couldn't do on the Sabbath day. And they defined the kinds of work. When Jesus came along, they declared he couldn't even heal on the Sabbath. And they jumped on him for healing the sick on the Sabbath. That's not what God had in mind in keeping the Sabbath day holy. The Sabbath, to be kept holy, had to begin in your heart. The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. What Jesus was doing was showing them that the spirit of the law runs deeper than the outward observance of the law. And therefore he said, unless your righteousness goes beyond that of the scribes and Pharisees, you cannot enter into the kingdom of God. And in this he was speaking of the kind of righteousness rather than the degree of it. And now as we resume in verse 21, we're going to see the several examples that Jesus gives of this. Ye have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not kill. And whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. But I say unto you that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whosoever shall say to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of the council. But whosoever shall say, thou fool, shall be in danger of hell fire. Therefore, if thou bring thy gift to the altar, and there rememberest that thy brother hath aught against thee, leave there thy gift before the altar, and go thy way. First, be reconciled to thy brother, and then come and offer thy gift. Note, Jesus starts here with the sixth commandment thou shalt not kill, which in its true rendering is murder. Thou shalt not murder. Therefore God, in giving this commandment, thou shalt not murder, neither forbade his people to go to war or to have capital punishment. He's saying first, whoever murders will have to answer to the court. And second, if murder is in your heart continuously, if it's there long enough festering inside you, that means you're going to murder. It's as if you've already done the deed. You are a murderer because you're living murder in your heart. And you're in danger with the court that cannot be seen, the court of Almighty God. Then he used the term raka, or being brainless or empty-headed, really giving vent to a violent passion and to fierce name-calling. He says they're going to jerk you up and judge you for that. Then he comes right to the heart of the matter, that when you come to the temple or the synagogue with a gift seeking forgiveness, and remember that you've wronged someone who has a just complaint against you, you've got to go and remove that stumbling block before you make your offering to God. When we bring our gifts to God, we've got to look inside our hearts and know that our heart is reaching out toward God and toward doing good in this world. It goes far beyond the giving of money, however it includes money. We just simply have to remember that our Lord is talking about the spirit of it, as much as he is talking about the giving of it. Verse 25. Agree with thine adversary quickly, whilst thou art in the way with him, lest at any time the adversary deliver thee to the judge, and the judge deliver thee to the officer, and thou be cast into prison. Verily I say unto thee, thou shalt by no means come out thence till thou hast paid the uttermost farthing. You have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say unto you, that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. Note, when the creditor is trying to do you a favor and make it possible for you to pay your debt, pay up what you owe. Be very careful. Be flexible. Assure him that you're going to start on it, that you're going to be bringing in payments, or he's going to deliver you up to the court of law. Now, in saying that, he uses it as a springboard to talk about the seventh commandment, thou shalt not commit adultery. And the audience who was listening to him knew exactly what he meant, because they knew that seventh commandment by heart. But Jesus is saying something about it that was in the original meaning when God gave the seventh commandment among the ten to Moses. He is saying that the immoral act begins in an immoral desire. He calls it the sin of lust. And Jesus dwells on the immoral desire to commit the overt act of adultery. Anyone who looks at a man or a woman with a persistent desire and just keeps on thinking, if I was with that man or with that woman, I would commit this deed. And you just keep on thinking that. He says you reach a point in time with that lust that it is the sin of adultery just as much as the act. Now, the desire and the act are different. I realize that. But as far as sin is concerned, he's saying you have already sinned. Someone says, well, then how can I handle life? Because bad thoughts are always coming into my mind. Lust is not a passing thought in your mind. Lust is not a bad dream in which you are with someone and you wake up so glad the dream isn't so. That's not what lust is. Jesus is realistic. He understands our humanness. And he, in effect, is telling us you don't have to live with this lust. I've given you the very spirit of myself, the spirit of purity, to where you don't have any deep desire to commit adultery. Now, if you're thinking that I've told you all this without giving you a way out, just hold on, because Jesus' sermon continues. Verse 29, and if thy right eye offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee, for it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not that thy whole body should be cast into hell. And if thy right hand offend thee, cut it off, and cast it from thee. For it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not that thy whole body should be cast into hell. Note, Jesus is not saying that we are to literally, physically, pluck the eye out of our head, or sever our right hand from our wrist. He's not talking about physical mutilation. If that's all he were talking about, then if you took your eye out or your hand off, you'd solve it all. But he's dealing with things in your heart. And if you took all your legs and arms and eyes out, severed them from your body, and it was still in your heart, you haven't gained a thing. Just as in a member of your body with gangrene that can't be cured is amputated, so he is saying, amputate from your being that thought, that idea, that lust, that thing that's pulling you down. And now you say, well, how do you do it? Jesus has so made you and me that we have the power of choice. When someone says, I don't have any willpower, he's lying, and you know he's lying. You and I do have willpower. We can choose, and God made us different from all the animals of the earth. We have the power of choice. Jesus handled it in a much more extreme circumstance. He said, not my will, but thine be done. I surrender my will to the Heavenly Father's will. I do that. God isn't going to come down and take Oral Roberts' will and twist it around to do what he wants it to do. Oral Roberts is going to exercise that will. And how do you do it? Well, you know, he's given us his holy word, the Bible. And the word of God is a two-edged sword. It divides the evil from the righteousness. It divides doubt from faith. It divides hate from love. It divides untruth from truth. The word of God is even more powerful than a two-edged sword, we're told in the book of Hebrews. Going to church. I go to church as often as possible. I'm in church myself through my own ministry. But when I'm not ministering, I'm in the house of God. What I'm trying to say in those two illustrations of the word and of going to the house of God is to say that there's a way. God makes a way. And what you feel that you can't eliminate from your life, you can, first by the exercise of your choice using your willpower, and then by your faith believing God is going to supernaturally help you. And believe me, He's a supernatural God. Let me add just one more word, and that is this. Cut off whatsoever tends to stimulate unholy passions in your life. Cut it off. For example, there are times that you just turn your television set off because of the type of program it's on it. Or you refuse to read certain magazines and books because of the unsavory material. And as I said, you can do it. Verse 31. It hath been said, whosoever shall put away his wife, let him give her a writing of divorcement. But I say unto you, that whosoever shall put away his wife, saving for the cause of fornication, causeth her to commit adultery. And whosoever shall marry her that is divorced, committeth adultery. Note, this statement of Jesus is still being argued about today. But friend, Jesus is speaking of what God originally had in mind, the ideal, and that is that marriage is totally sacred. Because of its sacredness, it produces something that's almost indescribable, a oneness, where the two flesh become one. And more than that, the two spirits become one. Now, anyone who breaks up that relationship is going to be judged severely. Now, in this day that Jesus was talking about, marriage had become so loosely carried on that the man could divorce his wife for practically anything if he didn't like the way she salted his food. He'd walk up and say, I divorce you, I divorce you, I divorce you. And get a piece of paper and say that he was divorced. And Jesus really had a hidden meaning here, that the woman had rights just as the man did. But he was also holding up the ideal. And he did not say that divorce is blaspheming the Holy Spirit. But he carefully put limits around the marriage and called divorce an intrusion, a breakage of that relationship that led in all kinds of suffering. The important thing for you to carry in your heart in what Jesus said here is that he was going beyond the letter of the law to the spirit. And we've got to be careful in being judgmental toward divorced persons just because of the letter of the law. There are hundreds of thousands of Christian men and women suffering over this thing right now and are being condemned just out of hand because they got divorced without knowing the spirit of the matter, without knowing the background of it. Let me tell you, we're dealing with a serious matter here, and in due time, you and I are going to face it face to face in the Word of God. Verse 33, again, you have heard that it hath been said by them of old time, thou shalt not forswear thyself, but shalt perform unto the Lord thine oaths. But I say unto you, swear not at all, neither by heaven, for it is God's throne, nor by the earth, for it is his footstool, neither by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great King. Neither shalt thou swear by thy head, because thou canst not make one hair white or black. But let your communication be yea, yea, nay, nay. For whatsoever is more than these cometh of evil. Note, Jesus here is going beyond just the saying of words or the making of vows. He's saying he's listening to every word we say. He is looking at our heart, which is behind everything that we say and every vow that we make. And he's saying there are some things we can't do. We can't change our hair white or black. And therefore, we ought to be straightforward, so that when we say yea or yes, we mean yes. When we say no, we mean no. We don't have something hidden inside us that conceals our true motives. In other words, our motive is to be centered in Christ, simple, sincere, and motivated in our hearts by Him. Verse 38, ye have heard that it hath been said, an eye for an eye, and a tooth for a tooth. But I say unto you, that ye resist not evil, but whosoever shall smite thee on thy right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if any man will sue thee at the law, and take away thy coat, let him have thy cloak also. And whosoever shall compel thee to go a mile, go with him twain. Note, Jesus is referring here to the occupying army of the Romans and the laws that they made against the Jewish people. For example, if a Roman came along carrying a heavy load and he met a Jew, he could compel him to carry it up to a mile. And then the Jew could hand it back. And the Roman couldn't do anything about it according to Roman law. But Jesus was saying, when you've carried it a mile, and the man wants you to carry it even a second mile, don't get mad and spit in his face and throw it off your shoulder. Just say to him, sir, I'll carry it a second mile. Jesus is saying it's not the letter of the law that counts, it's the spirit, which is love, that counts. In effect, he's saying, plant a seed of faith. Verse 42, give to him that asketh thee, and from him that would borrow of thee, turn not thou away. Ye have heard that it hath been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. But I say unto you, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. And pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you, that ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he maketh his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust. For if ye love them which love you, what reward have you? Do not even the publicans the same? And if ye salute your brethren only, what do you more than others? Do not even the publicans so? Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father, which is in heaven, is perfect. Note, Jesus is getting right down on our level and telling us that circumstances hit every one of us. And they keep on coming at us. And he's saying, don't deal with those from a legalistic standpoint, or just from the letter, or from the outward, but deal with them from your spirit, which is the way God made you. Your mind is limited in its ability to cope with that circumstance. Your body is limited in its ability to handle it. But your spirit is not limited. And especially when you're born of the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit is within your spirit, you have an unlimited power of the Holy God residing in you, and you can manifest that spirit toward these circumstances. Now, I believe Jesus is right. And I just encourage you and me and everyone else to live by His Spirit. Chapter 6. Take heed that you do not your alms before men to be seen of them, otherwise you have no reward of your Father which is in heaven. Therefore, when thou doest thine alms, do not sound a trumpet before thee, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may have glory of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But when thou doest alms, Let not thy left hand know what thy right hand doeth, that thine alms may be in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret himself shall reward thee openly. And when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father which is in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. But when ye pray, use not vain repetitions, as the heathen do, for they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. Be not ye therefore like unto them, for your Father knoweth what things you have need of before you ask him. Note, in dealing with prayer and in giving, Jesus is taking us back to the very Spirit of God which motivates our prayer and giving in the first place. And he's doing it upon a background where many of the Jewish people did their praying and their giving in a showy way, and to be praised of people. For example, when they brought their gifts to the synagogue or to the temple, there were chests that were trumpet-shaped, and when they dropped their large coins in them, it made a big sound, heralding the giver. And people would turn and say, look, isn't that something? So they got their reward from men. And when many of them prayed, they would raise their hands with palms outward, lift their voices high, and pray in such a way that when people saw them, people would turn and say, oh, what a praying person. Did you ever hear such a prayer in your life? And Jesus is saying, folks, you got it all wrong. When you pray, just make a closet in your heart and let your heart take charge of your praying, whether it's loud or whether it's quiet, whether it's public or whether it's private. Just let your heart do the praying. And when you give, don't let people around you dictate what you give. Let your heart do the giving. And when your heart does the giving, your Father's going to see your giving, and he's going to reward you openly, just as he does in rewarding you openly when you pray with your heart. You know, I really love God for so many reasons, but I love him because he's made it possible for us to pray in the Spirit, to pray in tongues, where we can actually pray under our breath. We can pray quietly in our private devotions. We can pray as we walk, as we sit, as we drive our car, as we work, when nobody's even listening. We don't have to be concerned how long the prayer is or how loud. We can pray in the Spirit, and then through interpretation of our tongue back to our mind, we can pray with our understanding. And we're going to talk a lot about that in 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Jesus is not telling you that you're not ever to pray in public or to give in public. He's not excluding your praying and giving from the sight or the hearing of other human beings. He's talking about the spirit in which you and I do it. If we do it only to impress those people, then our reward is from those people. And what a sorry reward that is. Because when the going gets rough, people can't do much for you. When push comes to shove, it's God that counts. Now, this is the backdrop for Jesus teaching us how to pray in what we commonly call the Lord's Prayer. Verse 9. After this manner, therefore, pray ye, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Note, we call this the Lord's Prayer, but it is really the believer's prayer, where Jesus told us to pray in this manner. It's always good to say this prayer and to use the very same words, but it's even better to take the spirit of what he said here and use that as the basis for all our prayers to our Heavenly Father. God is our source. It is from God that we receive everything. Therefore, our prayers are to be directly to Him, and our expectations are to be directly from Him. He mentions about the kingdom coming and God's will being done on this earth as it is in heaven. That heaven and earth are not divided. They're made by the same Creator. And that really we want what is happening in heaven to be happening down here on the earth. And we're to make that come to pass. And then Jesus is very careful to let us know his care about our food, shelter, and raiment. Give us this day our daily bread. As one lady said, life is so daily. Yes, that's the way it's supposed to be. It is daily. But thank God, God is daily. God is in every moment of our existence. In fact, the only unit of time he recognizes is the now. All the eternal past and all our future tomorrows are wrapped up into this special moment right now. When Jesus tells us that we are to forgive and we are to pray that we are not led into temptation, he is speaking again of our hearts, that we are to have a forgiving spirit because we're going to be wronged. Yes, there will be some temporary losses, even financially. But he is telling us that in our prayers, we should cover such events and forgive, because it is in our forgiveness that we receive the forgiveness of God. God is not going to lead us into temptation. He is telling us to pray that we will not enter into temptations that are too great for us. We're to ask for deliverance from the evil of this world, because the kingdom is God's, also the power and the glory, and it's forever. You and I live in time, but we also live in eternity. There is an eternity in our now, and there's now in our eternity. Our Father is telling us that he is God. He is source. He's everything. And as we wrap our daily lives around him, he's going to take care of us. Verse 14. For if ye forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if ye forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Moreover, when ye fast, be not as the hypocrites of a sad countenance, for they disfigure their faces, that they may appear unto men to fast. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, when thou fastest, anoint thine head, and wash thy face, that thou appear not unto men to fast, but unto thy Father which is in secret. And thy Father, which seeth in secret, shall reward thee openly. Note, again, Jesus Christ is appealing to us to live in the Spirit, to know that our heart is right with God, to speak from a forgiving heart and from a heart that is reaching up to do the will of the Father, not to make any public display of our spirituality for the sake of that display. Our attention is to be fully upon God. For why do we fast? We fast because we feel a need in our lives, a need to be closer to God, to be better able to release our faith in God, to have the ability to stand against all temptation and persecution, to resist evil. Therefore, our fast should be in the most humble way, with our entire attention upon our Heavenly Father, to give us strength, inner strength, to stand against everything. Verse 19. Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. The light of the body is the eye. If therefore thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be full of light. But if thine eye be evil, thy whole body shall be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in thee be darkness, how great is that darkness? No man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat or what you shall drink, nor yet for your body, what you shall put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body than raiment? Behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much better than they? Which of you by taking thought can add one cubit unto his stature? And why take you thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe ye, O ye of little faith? Therefore take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewithal shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Take therefore no thought for the morrow, for the morrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. Note, the sweep of history is involved here, that when it's all said and done, what counts is our relationship with our Heavenly Father. That's what Jesus is saying. In no way does he tell us that we are not to eat, to have clothes, houses, automobiles, lands, the things of this world that are necessary for both our existence and our progress. Jesus does not frown upon the things of his earth. He is not against us having things. He simply says, get your priorities straight. For example, he sums it all up in verse 33. But as for you, seek you first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Notice that they are to be added. How are they to be added? They're to be added through the Lord as we seek him. as we put him first in our lives, in our giving, in our believing, in our living, and in our receiving. And therefore, whatever we need of both heaven and earth will be ours, providing we seek the Lord with our whole heart and put him first in our lives. Chapter 7. Judge not that you be not judged. For with what judgment you judge, you shall be judged. And with what measure you meet, it shall be measured to you again. And why beholdest thou the mote that is in thy brother's eye, but considerest not the beam that is in thine own eye? Or how wilt thou say to thy brother, let me pull out the mote of thine eye, and behold, a beam is in thine own eye? Thou hypocrite, first cast out the beam out of thine own eye, and then shalt thou see clearly to cast out the mote out of thy brother's eye. Give not that which is holy unto the dogs, neither cast ye your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn again and rend you. Note, again, Jesus Christ is appealing to us in the inner man. We are to look inside and to see how we are serving the Lord. To me, Jesus is telling us to be wise. And if we'll be wise, he will put us on the right path. Verse 7. Ask, and it shall be given you. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh receiveth, and he that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be opened. Or what man is there of you, whom if his son ask bread, will he give him a stone? Or if he ask a fish, will he give him a serpent? If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your Father which is in heaven give good things to them that ask him? Note, he begins by saying ask, seek, knock. It's a fact if we don't ask, we'll never receive. If we don't seek, we'll not find. If we don't knock, the doors will not be opened. Therefore, we have to be aggressive in the spirit of asking, of reaching out. I believe the thrust of what Jesus is saying to you and me in the now through this passage is that God is a good God. And we are to view him above the goodness of men. If we can accept the fact that at times people are good, surely we can expect to believe that God is good all the time. God is a good God, and God will always be a good God. Verse 12. Therefore all things whatsoever ye would that men should do to you, do you even so to them. For this is the law and the prophets. Enter ye in at the strait gate. For wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat. Because strait is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. Note, he's not speaking here of a narrow physical road, but he's saying that in this world, which is on its way to hell because its whole system is unlike God and is against men's present and future welfare, that there's a better way. But it's a way that requires living by the Word of God, releasing our faith to God, and making up our minds. I am going to follow Christ. And friend, he says what he means and means what he says. Verse 15. Beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. Ye shall know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes of thorns, or figs of thistles? Even so every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. Wherefore by their fruits ye shall know them. Not every one that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man, which built his house upon a rock, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And every one that heareth these sayings of mine, and doeth them not, shall be likened unto a foolish man, which built his house upon the sand. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell. And great was the fall of it. Note, Jesus is warning us against outward professions, against unwarranted public displays. Again, he is appealing to our inner man that his spirit is within us, and that all of our deeds are to emanate and originate from within, not from without. For example, he says at the judgment there will be people coming to him and calling him by his name, Lord, and claiming that they've done many miracles. I want you to notice he doesn't agree with that. He simply says, I never knew you. Depart from me, because you have been living in your sins. Jesus is telling us that we are to build our lives upon Christ. And when we do, we are on the rock. And when we're on the rock, rather than the sands, our lives will endure. Not only now, but forever and ever. Verse 28. And it came to pass, when Jesus had ended these sayings, the people were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one having authority, and not as the scribes. Note, there is authority in the Word of God, in the life of our Savior Jesus Christ, and in our Christian experience today. We don't go around apologizing for our Christian life, or for doing good deeds, or for seeing miracles happen through the name of Christ, but we're to do what we do with authority, knowing in our hearts that God is our God and we are his children. Chapter 8. When he was come down from the mountain, great multitudes followed him. And behold, there came a leper and worshipped him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. And Jesus put forth his hand and touched him, saying, I will, be thou clean. And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. And Jesus saith unto him, See thou tell no man, but go thy way, show thyself to the priest, and offer the gift that Moses commanded for a testimony unto them. Note, the great question that the sick have, even today, is the same one that the leper had in Jesus' time. They say, if it be the will of God, But Jesus put that question down. He took care of it forever. He said, I will. Be thou clean. I believe without the shadow of a doubt that it is God's will to heal. Now, I believe he heals through medicine. I believe he heals through prayer. I believe he heals through love. I believe he heals through climate. Often he heals through all these things, since he's the source of healing. But he wants us well. Notice that he told the leper to tell no man about his healing. Some people think they are not to tell about their own healing because of this particular verse of Scripture. There may be an isolated instance when God sovereignly might not want us to relate a healing incident in our lives. But generally speaking, he wants us to tell it because others are waiting to hear it. And when they hear it, their faith is going to rise and many of them too will be delivered. Verse 5, and when Jesus was entered into Capernaum, there came unto him a centurion, beseeching him and saying, Lord, my servant lieth at home, sick of the palsy, grievously tormented. And Jesus saith unto him, I will come and heal him. The centurion answered and said, Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldest come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my servant shall be healed. For I am a man under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to this man, Go, and he goeth, and to another, Come, and he cometh, and to my servant, Do this, and he doeth it. When Jesus heard it, he marveled, and said to them that followed, Verily I say unto you, I have not found so great faith, no, not in Israel. And I say unto you, that many shall come from the east and west, and shall sit down with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the children of the kingdom shall be cast out into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And Jesus said unto the centurion, Go thy way, and as thou hast believed, so be it done unto thee. And his servant was healed in the selfsame hour. Note, in my view, the 8th chapter of Matthew's Gospel is the most powerful healing chapter in the Word of God. And this healing of the Roman army captain's servant, his simple faith, which Christ called great faith, may be the most perfect healing for us to study, for it contains in it the essential elements for us to base our faith on for our healing in the now. Notice that when he came to Christ and told him about his suffering servant, that Jesus said, I will come and heal him. Jesus has come. And he has come to heal. I will come and heal him. That's what was uppermost in Christ's mind. The deliverance of lost and suffering humanity. That's what he thinks about today. He's touched by the feelings of our infirmities. When we hurt, he feels our hurt. And he has come. Well, the servant was lying at a distance. And the Roman captain said, It's not necessary for you to come, Lord. I'm not a man worthy of your coming in my house. But I'm a man under authority. I know what authority is. When I tell a soldier to do a certain thing, he does it without questioning me. Because he knows that I speak in the authority of Caesar, the emperor of the Roman Empire, the mightiest force in the world. But Jesus, I know that you are a man under authority. You have the authority of heaven and earth. I have the authority of Caesar. But you have total authority. Speak in the authority of your own being. Just say the word, and tell this disease to leave my servant's body. And when you tell this disease to leave, it will submit to your authority, and my servant shall be healed. Jesus was so elated, he turned to the audience and said, look at this man. I've been searching for faith like his all over Israel, and I've not found it. This is what great faith is. This is encouraging to you and me because we don't have to be somebody special in order to have great faith. Jesus turned to this Roman army captain and said, you just go on home. I've spoken the word, and as he went, the servant was healed. One of the important things to point out here is a point of contact. The captain said, if you'll just say the word. That's like going over there and turning on a light switch, which is connected to the light company. The moment you flip the switch, the current flows through. The switch is the point of contact with the source of light power. So when you use a point of contact, such as this captain did, speak the word only, or you have the laying on of hands, or any similar thing, you have a point of contact with the power of God. It's good to have a point of contact because it helps you set the time and put your faith directly in line with God Himself. We need to read this passage over and over and learn that we as believers must center our faith upon the authority of our Lord. It means in the now that we have faith, no matter how small it is, in the authority of Christ, and when we release that faith, He's going to tell us the wonderful good news that we are being healed. Verse 14, and when Jesus was come into Peter's house, he saw his wife's mother laid and sick of a fever. And he touched her hand, and the fever left her, and she arose and ministered unto them. Note, here Peter's wife's mother was feverishly ill. She was in bed. Peter was a married man, and his mother-in-law lived with him. But this must have been a very loving woman, and they had great love for her. Well, when Jesus went home with Peter, he saw his mother-in-law, and he touched her hand. Can't you see that? He touched her hand, and the touch of the Master caused the fever to leave her. And she just got up out of bed, dressed, and immediately began to cook for them. Verse 16, when the evening was come, they brought unto him many that were possessed with devils. And he cast out the spirits with his word, and he healed all that were sick, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. Note, he's referring here to Isaiah 53:4. Jesus used his word. When he met those who were possessed with demons, he spoke the word, and he also healed their sick. We've been asked, who is a demon? What is a demon? Well, demons are fallen angels. Somewhere in the dateless past, there was war in heaven. We are told of this in Isaiah and in Ezekiel, where Lucifer, the bright shining archangel of God, who was the nearest to God, rose up in open rebellion and committed high treason against the Creator. And when he said, I will ascend above God, I will became sin. We sin with our will. Sin is no light thing. Sin is not a mistake that we make. Sin is not something we do when we don't know better. Sin is a willful thing. It is when we know and then we will to do wrong. This is what Lucifer did. He knew that God was God, but in his heart, he willed to rise above God, to set God aside, and to become God himself. A great portion of the angels followed him in this rebellion, and God said, "There is sin in your heart, and I will cast you out to the earth,